Dear brothers and sisters, on behalf of Brigham Young University and Religious Education, it's my privilege to welcome each of you to our 2019 Easter Conference. We hope all of you can find a seat and you feel welcome to be here. We're grateful to have your presence. We'd especially like to extend a warm welcome to our speakers this evening. We'd like to acknowledge Professor Barbara Morgan Gardner and her husband somewhere. Dustin is in the audience, I believe. And also Professor Richard Bushman, his wife, Professor Claudia Bushman, couldn't be with us, but we wish her well. And Elder Bruce Hafen and his wife, Marie Hafen, are here with us. We're thrilled to be hearing from them and look forward to their messages. This will be embarrassing for them, but I'd also like to recognize the Easter Conference Committee, those who have from our college who put together this program tonight. And they're probably scurrying about trying to make all the last-minute arrangements, but Charles Swift is our chair of this committee. Charles, there he is, hand raised over here. Charles, thank you. Just stay standing, would you? Embarrass you as long as we can here. And Michael McKay, Brother McKay, there he is in the back, all right. And also Brent Nordgren from Religious Studies Center here at BYU. And Hank Smith from Ancient Scripture, also a member of our committee. I don't see many of them. I can't see well, but we're sure grateful for these fine professors and staff who've helped to make this conference a success. We'd like to formally begin this Easter conference by singing together, "He is Risen." The words will appear on the screen behind me, and our chorister is Bailey Morris from Vineyard, Utah, who's a graduate of our BYU's Music Dance Theater program. And the pianist is Christian Warrow, senior majoring in social science, teaching from Orem, Utah. And her invocation will be given by Tina Ting Lin, a junior majoring in food science from the People's Republic of China. And we'll go to that part of the program. Thank you.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we're so very grateful for this peaceful night that we get together here. And Heavenly Father, we're grateful for our speakers tonight that and the message they have prepared. And Father, we're grateful that we can have this time to listen and to learn from them. And we pray that Thy Spirit can be with us and that the questions that we are that we have brought to this conference can be answered. And we pray for our family and friends, and we pray for those who are on their way that they can make it safely. And we say these things in the name of Thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Tina, thank you very much. You know, Tina represents our students here at BYU quite well. before the program started, she wondered if she should pray in Mandarin or English. And just really symbolic of the great students we have here. And we're thankful for her and for all the students at BYU and all of those who make their coming here possible as well. We're grateful for the public, you who live here in the Valley and even the Salt Lake Valley and come and be a part of this conference. We're grateful to you. We do have several that are still trying to find seats. Maybe if you would be willing to scoot in a bit or raise your hand if there are seats by you. Just let it be known that there's a seat or two that somebody could come and join. The ushers we have, if you'd notice these hands in the air, we'd love to have as many seats made available as possible. Thank you. Now, there are some biographical statements in your program for each of our speakers, but there are just a few more words that I'd like to say and as we prepare to be taught by these three wonderful individuals. Tonight, our first speaker will be Professor Barbara Morgan Gardner. Professor Gardner is an associate professor of church history and doctrine at Brigham Young University. Barbara served a mission in Los Angeles, California, where her major assignment was the visitor center. And Sister Gardner has also taught on the church's seminary and institute program of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And one of her assignments was to direct the Institute of Religion in Boston, where she also served as a chaplain at both Harvard and MIT. Professor Gardner is a great blessing to her students here at BYU. She's known for the energy that she brings to the classroom, as well as her knowledge of the gospel, the love she has for her students, and her deep and abiding testimony of the Savior. We're grateful to have Barbara as a member of our faculty. In addition to working with Barbara in religious education, I'm blessed to work with her at Deseret Book. We both serve on the board of review there, and I've just learned to appreciate her thorough and gracious and thoughtful manner in the work that she does. So we're very pleased to hear from Barbara here in just a few minutes. After Sister Gardner speaks to us, it'll be our privilege to hear from Professor Richard Bushman. After Brother Bushman served a mission in the Northeast, he finished his degrees, both undergraduate and graduate, at Harvard University. And following that, he taught at Brigham Young University and Harvard University, Boston University, University of Delaware, and also Columbia University. He retired from Columbia in 2001. To work full-time on his landmark biography of Joseph Smith, Rough Stone Rolling. From 2008 to 2011, Professor Bushman served as the Howard W. Hunter Chair of Mormon Studies at Claremont Graduate University. Over the years, Professor Bushman has been a great friend of BYU, beginning his professional career here at BYU. And he's returned many times to give presentations and participate in conferences and work closely with faculty, students. In fact, earlier today, I asked one of the associate deans in religious education, J.B. Hawes, what has been his experience also as a historian with Professor Bushman. And he'd been reading something Professor Bushman wrote just a few minutes before. And he said, Dan, let me read this to you. And I want to read it to you now. A quote from Professor Bushman. I've always believed that the BYU faculty, their chief responsibility is to emphasize faith and not to suppress doubt, unquote. Brother Bushman's ability to build faith and address doubt has been a blessing to many inside and outside the church, and we're very grateful to have him here with us tonight. After Professor Gardner and Professor Bushman speak to us, we'll have a musical number, How Great Thou Art, by Taylor and Bailey Morris, and they will be accompanied by Christian Warrow. And then I'll introduce Elder Hafen following that. So, Sister Gardner.
Brothers and sisters, it's a pleasure and also a humbling experience, of course, to be here with you tonight. Speaking with Brother Bushman and Elder Hafen is not only a pleasure, but it's a blessing to be able to be among them, listening to them. But also it's a blessing to be among all of you. I've looked out and seen many students here and faculty members, family members, friends, people in the neighborhood, those who are associated with BYU and have been over the years, and all of you that of course I don't know, but I'm grateful that you are here as we can all have this experience together, reflecting on and coming to better understand and know Jesus Christ and our relationship with him, especially as the focus is on Easter. So thank you so much for coming, and thank you for allowing the Spirit to teach us even more fully as we experience this time together. Every semester, this one included, my students spend a significant amount of time studying the scriptures on their own and writing a one-page paper regarding a Christ-like attribute of their choice. They then apply that attribute throughout the semester and present what they have learned in a one-on-one interview with me. As part of their assignments, these students produce an artifact, such as a video, a journal, a photo, a poem, a dance performance, whatever they decide, to represent their experience as a final product for the class. I'm consistently humbled and inspired and amazed by the growth and creativity of these students. The day that I do these interviews, or the weekend that I do these interviews, has become my favorite of the entire semester. One of my favorite interviews occurred with a young woman who, rather than selecting a specific Christ-like attribute, chose to study and apply the atonement of Jesus Christ instead. After explaining what she had studied and applied, I asked to see her creative product. With a huge smile and tears running down her cheeks, she stood up from her seat and exclaimed, "It's me." She explained that as she applied the atonement of Jesus Christ, she began praying more frequently, thinking of him more often, relying on and trusting him, and desiring to become like him. "I'm a different person," she expressed. "I'm a better person. Because of him, I'm becoming like him, and I'm happier than I've ever been in my life." I recognized at that moment there was no product that could have been better that she could have displayed for her semester end than herself. I often tell my students, don't use that as an excuse. It's already been done once. So good for her, but let's see something else for you. The miracle that had occurred in her life as she used her agency to learn and apply the atonement of Jesus Christ was absolutely obvious. President Nelson explained that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son to help us. And his Son, Jesus Christ, gave his life for us, all so that we could have access to godly power. Power sufficient to deal with burdens, obstacles, and temptations of our day. He continued, "The more we know about the Savior's ministry and mission, the more we understand his doctrine and what he did for us, the more we can know that he can provide the power that we need for our lives. Then as we act upon that knowledge and choose to have faith in him and follow him, that faith then motivates us to more action and gives us even more access to his power." In one of the greatest revelations regarding the potential of mankind, the Lord taught the following in the Doctrine and Covenants. "Then shall they be above all, because all things are subject unto them. Then shall they be gods, because they have all power." This power is not received in one full swoop in mortality. It is not simply poured out upon us on the day of resurrection. President Nelson taught, in his most thoughtful and instructive way, perfection pending, he said, "We need not be dismayed if our earnest efforts towards perfection now seem so arduous and endless. Perfection is pending. It can come in full only after the resurrection and only through the Lord." It is in this same talk that President Nelson clarifies the distinction between two perfections: first, mortal perfection, and second, eternal perfection. Jesus indeed was mortally perfect according to mortal standards of not sinning, but he was not eternally perfect until he received the fullness of the Father. No human can be mortally perfect, but the possibility of eternal perfection is pending. As Elder Maxer reminded us, only as we become partakers of the divine nature are we qualified to become partakers of divine power. And I would add, only as we acquire and act upon his divine power is he able to perfect us through his use of his divine gift. Although there are many principles of power in relation to eternal perfection, tonight we're going to look at just three. So first, Christ's divine power as a dual-natured individual of both God and man. Second, the power of obedience made available through Christ's perfect use of agency. And third, Christ's power made possible in great part because of his love, which allowed him to overcome sin and death and thus allow him to endow us with his power and eventually eternal perfection as a gift for those who are willing to abide by his law. So let's look at this first principle, power, in relation to eternal perfection, the power of the divine. Christ's perfect life and divine powers of mortality are a testimony of his dual nature, both as God and man. Many of us are familiar with this scripture from the Book of Mormon regarding Abinadi. So Abinadi, in his final discourse on Christ, declared, "Because he dwelleth in the flesh, he shall be called the Son of God. And having subject the flesh to the will of the Father, being the Father and the Son, the Father because he was conceived by the power of God, and the Son because of the flesh, thus becoming the Father and the Son. Yea, even so he shall be led, crucified and slain, the flesh being subject even unto death, and the will of the Son being swallowed up in the will of the Father. And thus God breaketh the bands of death, having gained the victory over death, giving the Son power to make intercession for the children of men." Although we know cognitively that this is the case, many of us try to bear it for ourselves, even to the point of trying to perfect ourselves, even while knowing that it is literally impossible, thinking that somehow as mortals that we have some kind of power that we frankly don't. On the other hand, there are some of us who expect eventual perfection, regardless of our actions, based on a fairy tale false hope in an unknown and misunderstood God. So there are two sides, one who believes that they can do it by themselves and one who believes that no matter what they do, they're going to be perfected. Regardless of what side of the spectrum that they are on or that we are on, and typically it's somewhere in between, I have come to understand that the fundamental ingredient of both sides and everyone in between who thinks that they can possibly do it by themselves or do not need Christ at all is faith in, dependence on, and reliance on Jesus Christ. On the topic of coming to really know Christ, President Nelson declared the following: "It is impossible for us to be saved in ignorance. The more we know about the Savior's ministry and mission, the more we understand his doctrine and what he did for us, the more we know that he can provide the power we need for our lives. Many, including many of my own students and including myself in the past, have misunderstood Alma's invitation to experiment upon the seed. Many compare the seed to faith, when in all reality, the seed is compared by Alma to the Word, as is stated in Alma 33:21, the Son of God. Alma declared, "Cast about your eyes and begin to believe in the Son of God, that he will come to redeem his people, and that he shall suffer and die to atone for the sins, for their sins, and that he shall rise again from the dead, which shall bring to pass the resurrection, that all men shall stand before him, to be judged at the last day, according to their works. And now, my brethren, I desire that you should plant this word in your hearts." It is Christ, not faith, that we are to be experimenting upon. And it is us, not Christ, that is being put to the test. In the revelation known as the vision, Christ taught of exalted beings in the celestial kingdom. He instructed, "They are they who received the testimony of Jesus and believed on his name and were baptized, and thus received the fullness of the Father." And then comes this humbling, most instructive verse: "These are they who are just men made perfect through Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, who wrought out this perfect atonement through the shedding of his own blood." Eternal perfection, brothers and sisters, and therefore exaltation, comes only through the Savior. We simply cannot perfect ourselves. Eternal perfection is only for the exalted, and it is only possible through Jesus Christ. no matter how many scriptures we read, how often we fast, how many hours we spend on our knees, how often we attend the temple, it is Christ, not us, who does the perfecting. Many of us bury our heads, checking off our lists, confusing the means with the end, thinking that the completed checklist is the final product. For some, we become masterful at checking off lists at the expense of coming to know the master. John Taylor taught that a man only has the powers within himself to become a man, but through the essence and power of the Godhead, which is in him, which descended to him as the gift of God from his heavenly Father, he is capable of rising from the contracted limits of manhood to the dignity of God. This is only possible, Taylor continued, through a power which is superior to man, infinite power, an eternal power, even the power of the Godhead. As we know and is oft quoted, Moroni instructs us to come unto Christ and states that it is only through his grace that we may be perfected in Christ. He taught that if we are perfect in Christ and deny not his power, then we will be sanctified in Christ by the grace of God through the shedding of the blood of Christ, which is the covenant of the Father unto the remission of your sins. Brothers and sisters, we increase the Savior's power in our lives, President Nelson instructed, when we make sacred covenants and keep those covenants with precision. Our covenants bind us to him and give us godly power. We don't earn his grace, but rather we make and keep covenants which allows him, through his grace, to endow us with his power and to eventually and eternally perfect us. We become literally yoked with him as we make and keep covenants with him, therefore allowing his power to become ours and allowing us to become joint heirs with him. Of all that he has, it is difficult, if not impossible, to be yoked with an eternal God if he is distant from us. The closer we are to God, the more likely we are to be yoked to him. C.S. Lewis painted a pragmatic picture of Christ yoking himself to us. He said the following, "Make no mistake," quoting Christ, he says, "if you let me, I will make you perfect. The moment you put yourself in my hands, that is what you are in for. You have free will, and if you choose, you can push me away. But if you do not push me away, understand that I am going to see this job through. Whatever suffering it may cost you in your earthly life, whatever inconceivable purification it may cost you after death, whatever it costs me, I will never rest, nor will I let you rest until you are literally perfect, until my Father can say without reservation that he is well pleased with you, as he said he was well pleased with me," referring to Christ. God desires to endow all of his children with his power, but rather not the world's power, but rather the power to overcome the world, the power necessary for eternal perfection. Elder Maxwell stated, "Our perfect Father does not expect us to be perfect children yet. He had only one such child. Meanwhile, therefore, sometimes with smudges on our cheeks, dirt on our hands, and shoes untied, stammeringly but smilingly, we present God with a dandelion, as if it were an orchid or a rose. If for now the dandelion is the best we have to offer, he receives it, knowing what we may later place on the altar. It is good to remember how young we are spiritually." It is absolutely important for all of us in mortality to remember that although we may perfect certain things in this life, we may have, again, perfect attendance at church, pass a test perfectly, have a perfect score, perform a perfect piece of music, iron our clothes perfectly, say just the perfect thing in just the perfect way, create a perfect dessert, drive a perfect car. This is not the eternal perfection of which the Lord speaks. We may perfectly do all the Lord has asked us to do and yet not obtain the perfection of which God grants. Eternal perfection, once again, is a gift from God, not earned in mortality, but granted in eternity, not equated with sinlessness and mortal perfectionism, but rather made possible only through the sinless one, for those who know him and have reverence for him as a God. Once on earth as a dual, perfect, and eventually eternally perfected being, it is only through this person and his power that we can become eternally perfected. The second principle of perfection demonstrated by Christ was and is his power to obey and to do so using his perfect agency, choosing to use his agency perfectly. Christ's use of agency to perfectly obey the will of the Father endowed him with the power necessary to eternally perfect us. Jacob taught that in premortality, Christ suffered himself to become subject unto man in the flesh. Then, prior to Christ's entrance into mortality, Christ declared that he came to do the will of the Father and of the Son. The last words Christ uttered in mortality, "Father, it is finished, thy will is done," were echoed as he spoke to the Nephites after his crucifixion, "I have suffered the will of the Father in all things from the beginning." It wasn't simply that Christ was obedient, it was Christ chose to be obedient. It seemed that whatever Christ desired was in complete line with his Father's will, and he had the power within himself to obey that will. The plea to have this cup pass from me was his first utterance noted in the scriptural text, which was seemingly out of line with his Father's will. And thus the humble and meek phrase, "Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt," became so poignant. Elder Maxwell taught, "Cognitively he knew it all, only as a God could, but experientially as a mortal, his obedience was tested beyond compare. Thus, when the agony came in its fullness, it was so much, much worse than even he, with his unique intellect, had ever imagined." It seems that it was the submitting of his own will and power to the Father's that he gained his greatest power. Therefore, it was not simply in Christ's obedience that produced the power necessary to fulfill his atonement, but the righteous and perfect use of his agency to be obedient. If eternal life rested merely on our obedience, our Father in heaven could have chosen to force strict obedience by providing no other alternatives. Perhaps, brothers and sisters, he could have given us immediate consequences for choices by ensuring immediate rewards and immediate punishment based on our actions, known only to the decision maker prior to the choice. Mere obedience is simply not enough. Thus, just as Christ both chose and did the will of the Father, resulting in him receiving divine power, we too must not simply obey, but rather turn our will over to his, and acting in obedience to his will, thus allowing him to fill us with his power. As Elder Maxwell taught, our deepest desires determine our degree of obedience to the unenforceable. President Kimball illuminated the importance of this phrase, the phrase, "Thy will be done," when he explained that if he himself had limitless power and yet limited vision and understanding, he might have saved Abinadi from the fire, and in so doing, destroyed the possibility of him being a martyr. In that same note, he may have saved the prophet and the patriarch in Carthage jail, and thus lost for them the martyr's death and the martyr's reward. He then adds this very sombering thought: if it was just simply up to President Kimball with what he knew at the time, he might have saved Christ from suffering death and lost to the world his atoning sacrifice, frustrating the whole program. Indeed, in order to become recipients of Christ's power, we must humbly accept that his ways are indeed higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Sometimes we just simply need to be humble. In the book of Luke, we are taught that with God, nothing shall be impossible. But coupled only with the understanding that thy will be done, will this principle come to fruition. How else could it be that we learn patience through suffering, love through experience, forgiveness through repentance? Was the real miracle in the healing of the 10, or was it in the one made whole? Was the miracle in the feeding of the 5,000, or in the deep conversion of his disciples? Elder Maxwell instructed that consecration thus constitutes the only unconditional surrender, which is also total victory. In this total victory, God pours out his infinite power. It is in giving our agency to God and desiring and expecting the impossible, only when it is his will, that we are showing true Christ-like obedience. Elder Del G. Renland of the Quorum of the Twelve instructed, "The closer we are to Jesus Christ in the thoughts and the intents of our hearts, the more we appreciate his innocent suffering, the more grateful we are for grace and forgiveness, and the more we want to repent and to become like him." Brothers and sisters, perhaps rather than spending our time and energy seeking miracles, it would be well worth our effort to seek the miracle giver. Perhaps this is why the third group in Lehi's dream fell at the feet of Christ rather than looking horizontally for mortal approbation. This group focused their lives on the Savior. They paid a very heavy price to do so. Thus, when they partook of the fruit, falling to the feet of the Savior was their natural inclination. President Nelson communicated the stretching necessary to receive God's power. He stated, "When the Savior knows you truly want to reach up to him, when he can feel that the greatest desire of your heart is to draw his power into your life, you will be led by the Holy Ghost to know exactly what you should do. It is this desire, coupled with our faith in Jesus Christ, that propels us to do things we otherwise would not do. There is nothing easy or automatic about becoming such powerful disciples." In fact, according to President Nelson, it is this very faith in Jesus Christ that motivates us to action, which gives us more access to his power. Indeed, the Savior himself understands what it means to stretch. Elder Maxwell reminded us, Jesus' brief stumbling while carrying the cross is a reminder as to how close to the very edge of our strength God stretches us at times. Just as Christ turned to his Father during his stretching, using his divine gift of agency, we too must turn to Christ during our most difficult moments. In somber reality, however, Christ, although he turned to his Father, was left to himself. We, on the other hand, are not. Where we turn during our stretching experiences often is a manifestation of the price we have paid to know him. Third, his power of love. It is clear that we love him because he first loved us. Elder Callister instructed, "The Savior exercised power as he endured the consequences of sin, withstood pain, and eventually relinquished his life. The exercise of those powers necessary to endure the suffering of all mankind may in turn have opened the door to the additional powers needed to resurrect, to redeem, and to exalt." Elder Callister continued, "Out of the death of one was born everlasting life for all." Clearly, as Alma taught, Christ suffered for our temptations, afflictions, and afflictions of every kind. In fact, Alma continues, "Christ took upon him death that he may loose the bands of death." Was it the mortal experience of overcoming and taking upon himself our temptations, sins, infirmities, weakness, and even death that gave him the power to overcome? In addition to gaining power by overcoming our sins, infirmities, and weaknesses, Christ also overcame his own temptations. As Christ withstood, or in fact gave no heed to the temptations of Satan in his younger years, he was more empowered to fight the temptation of Satan at the cross when he was left alone with no power to draw upon but his own, including in the Garden of Gethsemane. It was during the culminating experience of Gethsemane and on the cross when Christ endured his greatest suffering and also perhaps where his greatest power in mortality was manifest. His obedience to his Father's will gave him power to obey in the garden and on the cross when the temptation to falter was the strongest. President Nelson taught, "Jesus suffered deeply because he loves us deeply." It seems true then that Jesus Christ, because of his power of love, was able to have power over pain and suffering. Indeed, it was Christ's infinite attributes, capped in his infinite love, that provided infinite power, power to resurrect, power to redeem, and power to exalt. As Christ perfected his infinite attributes, he gained the infinite power to perform the infinite atonement and to perfect us, motivated by and through the power of his love. Elder Callister again instructed, "The atonement was both an exercise of power and an acquisition of power." He continued, "It should be no surprise that as we become more godlike, we become more powerful. The acquisition of each divine trait brings power." This power of charity, or the pure love of Christ, Elder Bednar taught, ultimately possesses us. We do not possess it. I remember my mother aspirating as a result of the radiology she was exposed to as she battled brain cancer just 2 months before she passed away. Upon awaking from a medically induced coma with a tube down her throat, making her unable to talk, she motioned to me for a piece of paper. "How is Susan?" she scribbled. Susan is my husband's mother, who at the time was struggling with terminal lung cancer. my mother's immediate and natural concern was not for herself, but for someone else that she knew was struggling. Her next note was a cheerful recognition that it was my birthday. Charity was something she did. It was a power she possessed, gained as a gift through a life of making covenants with and trying to be like Jesus Christ. Like Christ, I believe much of my mother's suffering was swallowed up in her love. On a similar note, following Susan's passing, Gary, Susan's husband, took much of the food brought to him and delivered the food to his neighbors, concerned that perhaps they might not have enough. I am confident that all three of these people, now passed beyond mortality, are well on their way to eternal perfection through Christ. I've often wondered how these individuals, and many, many more like them, many of whom are sitting in this room, including Christ himself, during times of their greatest agony or test, were able to reach outward instead of inward with a seeming power of charity beyond their own. President Iron gave this answer to this query. The fruit of keeping covenants is the companionship of the Holy Ghost and an increase in power to love. That happens because of the power of the atonement of Jesus Christ to change our very natures. Thus, in order to become like him, President Nelson taught, our focus must be riveted on the Savior and his gospel. So we make Jesus Christ the center of everything. As we're taught in the scriptures, we talk of Christ, we rejoice in Christ, we preach of Christ, we prophesy of Christ, we write according to our prophecies. In addition, we learn of Christ, we rely on Christ, we trust Christ, we exercise faith in Christ, we apply the teachings of Christ, and keep our covenants with Christ. And as we do so, our ability to become like Christ will increase, as will his power in us. We too then, in our final interview, will be able, with humble adoration, to present ourselves as my student did to me, eternally, however, perfected. Before the true interview, and be able to testify, it's me, knowing perfectly well that this new, powerful, eternally perfected self is only possible through Jesus Christ. As the hymn states, Savior, Redeemer of my soul, whose mighty hand hath made me whole, whose wondrous power hath raised me up and filled with sweet my bitter cup, make me more worthy of thy love and fit me for the life above. In the name of Jesus Christ, our eternally perfect Redeemer and resurrected Savior, who makes it possible for us to live with him and our families for eternity through his perfect resurrection. In his name, amen.
Brothers and sisters, I'm honored to be here with you tonight, join Elder Hafen and Sister Gardner in this Easter worship service. I'm impressed that so many of you chose to come. I guess Easter is a time for us to reflect on how the Savior figures in our lives, something we should do more often. We sense the potential of tapping into his power. Sister Gardner has so eloquently expressed it, and lament our inability to fully embrace him. In this season, we can reassess what we think of Christ and pledge ourselves once more to love him. From my early years, I have wondered what more I could do to draw from the Savior. What am I missing? When I was a young man, I didn't know what to think about the atonement. Everything I heard led me to believe it was central to worship and thought in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Yet, it did not make much difference to me. So far as I could tell, the atonement had two effects. One was to guarantee resurrection for all mortals. The second was to grant forgiveness to everyone who repented and believed in Christ. That is how I read Amulek's discourse on the atonement in the 34th chapter of Alma. Both were important blessings, but neither figured very much in my personal worship. The resurrection, the first blessing of the atonement, occurred automatically, without any effort on my part. I could be grateful for the gift, but it was to be received in the distant future and did not require anything of me now. It was more a formality and offered little reason to think of Christ day by day. Forgiveness, the second blessing, required that I repent, and once that was accomplished, Christ guaranteed that I would be accepted by the Father at the last day if I believed in him. I imagined him standing there at the judgment seat to assure the judge that I was okay. The Savior would make all the difference at judgment day, but not right now. The effort now was all directed at overcoming my sins, something I had trouble accomplishing. Repentance was the big hurdle. Once that was done, Christ would take care of the rest. For the time being, I didn't have to think much about Christ. So why was the Savior the center of life? I asked myself. If he intervened mainly after death, I could not see how our doctrine compelled me to love Christ, to think of him. He was there, ready to lend a hand when the time came to be resurrected or to get the judge's official approval at the judgment day. I was grateful for both blessings, but saw no reason to think about the Savior. His functions were legalistic. He served no purpose in everyday affairs. Over the years, my views of Christ changed, helped by a new appreciation of the Savior among my brothers and sisters. I began to use the phrase, the atonement in everyday life, which by implication was in contrast to Christ at judgment or Christ at resurrection. It slowly dawned on me that the atonement came into play more broadly than I had imagined and was vital all the time, not just at the end. It was not something that took effect only when we were resurrected or at the judgment seat. Going beyond those undoubted blessings, the atonement helped all the pains of life, the foolish errors we make, the hurts we inflicted, our defeats and disappointments, our fears, our failures, our illnesses. Wherever we fall short or suffer or fall down, Christ is there to pick us up, mend us, strengthen us, and send us on our way. Far from being a remote event that took hold mainly at the end of life, the atonement I came to see applies to all the things that concern us most. All my struggles and strivings, my everyday hopes and fears, my failures. I cannot say actually how this enlarged view of the atonement came to be. For a while, I thought I'd worked it out on my own and had to persuade other Latter-day Saints to think this way. Then, as I listened more closely, I realized that lots of people were coming around to this point of view. It was being preached from the pulpit all the time. Comprehensive atonement, the atonement in our everyday affairs, went along with a renewed emphasis on grace. When I was young, the doctrine of grace was foreign to Latter-day Saints. Grace was Paul and Protestantism. This restored gospel of Jesus Christ was James and works. I remembered thinking grace was a dangerous doctrine. The idea of a free gift was too much like welfare aid. It would deplete the incentive to work. In contrast to Pauline grace, we believed back then in making lists of virtues as Benjamin Franklin famously did, and striving to incorporate them through force of will. Willpower was the big word. You pretty much had to do it all yourself. When I went wrong, I blamed it on lack of willpower. Grace might be an embellishment at the end of life, but was not vital to finding God day by day now. Under the atonement in everyday life principle, I saw the atonement as more of a free gift to a person unable to overcome sin unaided. The aid I was seeking was more like Protestant grace, something I could not really earn, but desperately needed. I could not redeem myself by force of will. Willpower was precisely what I lacked. I needed help from beyond myself, an augmentation of strength, something I desired but was not worthy of. What I needed was grace. As the application of the atonement grew in scope, the sacrament prayers assumed new importance in my thinking. Sometimes people talk about their favorite scripture. As I see it, the favorite scripture in our church services are the two sacrament prayers found in Doctrine and Covenants 20:77 and 79. These are the scriptures we hear in church more than any other. Nearly every Sunday, they are spoken by priests kneeling behind the sacrament table. We are all enjoined to pause, clear our minds, and listen to the prayers in silence. Their message apparently is one that the Lord wants lodged in our hearts. I now think quite a bit about how to remember him always. According to the sacrament prayer, that is the key to having his spirit with us always. If we could learn how to remember Christ always, we would be much better off. If we had his spirit with us always, we would be more intelligent. Our instincts would tend toward goodness. We would be kind and helpful. We would think of other people more than ourselves. We would be strong and confident. The atonement in everyday life would really amount to something if we could live a life dictated by the Spirit of God. When I talk to people who are losing faith in the church, I put these two prayers to work. I often talk to members whose faith has been undermined by historical problems or who disagree with some church policy. They have concrete objections to this event in church history or that action by church leaders. Once I used to try to answer their objections with a counter-argument. I thought if I could resolve their problems, their faith would return. But I found through experience that they would either disagree with me, or if I persuaded them, they would, on one point, they would raise another objection. They had more issues than I could possibly deal with. And no matter what I said, they showed no signs of reversing course. Frustrated, I came around finally to asking them a simple question. How do you feel about Jesus Christ? In some ways, it seemed beside the point. They were dealing with something specific. What difference did Christ make? On the other hand, the question seemed to go to the heart of the matter. If they said Christ meant everything to them, I said, you will be all right. Follow your instincts, and you will arrive at the truth. On the other hand, if they said they had lost faith in Christ, along with their faith in Joseph Smith, I knew the problem went deeper. It appeared that this second group had built their faith on Joseph Smith and church history. And when that crumbled, the whole structure collapsed. They lost faith in God as well as in Joseph Smith. We had failed them in making Joseph the foundation on which everything rested and not teaching Christ first. Oftentimes, spiritual and intellectual problems are put in a new light if we focus on Christ. If a person's religion consists only of the words in the sacrament prayer, she probably has a pretty firm foundation on which to build. Taking on his name, covenanting to keep his commandments, and above all, remembering him always, can do a lot to keep a person alive spiritually, whatever their questions, doubts, and problems. At certain points in life, Christ can be a lifesaver, especially for teenagers. Over the years, as a bishop, a stake president, and as a father, I realized that most teenagers live double lives. They live a life that is visible to their parents, their Sunday school teachers, their bishops, perhaps even to their church friends. There's also another life, a hidden life, known only to themselves or a few friends. The first life is the one their parents and church leaders have taught them to live. The second is the one that begins to develop in their teen years. Often it has to do with sexual experience of one kind or another, but it can be lying, stealing, cheating, or breaking the word of wisdom. It may be terrible struggles with friends or teachers. This is the concealed life that they keep hidden from view. This life may cause the teenagers to feel terribly guilty, or perhaps to enjoy forbidden pleasures in rebellion against the oppressive adult world, or to feel alone and helpless. As this secret life develops, the young person is divided. He or she makes one thing known to the adults, while living another life below the surface. Knowing he is a hypocrite, he thinks everyone is a hypocrite. Kids in this position may become sullen and resentful, resistant to church involvement or family occasions. They may withdraw and refuse to communicate. They think the conventional life is stupid or oppressive. Others may keep up a good front and really want to be upright, but are still drawn in one degree or another to the dark side. They all suffer from guilty consciences. This double life is unstable and calls for change, but young people encounter a structural obstacle in church teachings. Sometimes the church actually makes it hard to repent. In an effort to protect young people against sin, teachers erect walls around their charges. They warn them of the dangers of sin and the beauties of righteousness. They try to make it as hard as possible to trespass into regions of darkness. They make the wall higher and thicker, ever more impregnable. But what if the young person trespasses nonetheless? What if instead of living within the walled cities, the budding sinners find themselves on the other side of the wall, on the outside? What had been a protection against sin now becomes a barrier against a return to the realm of happiness and righteousness. They see people around them cheerful and happy, quite complacent about their righteous lives, while the young people feel cut off with nowhere to go except to wander in the dark and misty plain. As a young faculty member at Brigham Young University, I was asked to talk to a group of mutual girls about navigating the teenage years. I spent my time erecting the wall against sin higher and higher, thicker and thicker, determined to keep them in the realm of safety. In the question period, an older man, probably a bishop, asked what should happen if one of the girls found herself in transgression. What should she do? I suddenly reversed myself and started throwing down all the bricks I'd used to build the wall, trying to open a way for the transgressor's return. In my younger years, our teachings on repentance were not very helpful. We had simple formulas about recognizing our sins, perhaps confessing them, renouncing them, compensating those we had hurt, and then being restored to the favor of God. We could sum it all up with four R's or something or other like that. It all seems so pat and beside the point, nowhere descriptive of the actual dilemmas and struggles of sin. Teachers in the church are hindered in teaching forgiveness by their inhibitions about retelling stories from their own sinful pasts. In evangelical churches, the master narrative for many sermons is a confession. I was a sinner, lost and depraved, until I found Jesus who rescued me. The darker the sins, the more compelling the story of salvation. In our church, the leaders don't talk about their sinful pasts and their moments of repentance. We fear we will license our young people to sin freely in the belief that they will be able to return as did their leaders before them. But not hearing stories of actual sin, repentance, and forgiveness, Latter-day Saint sinners are at a loss what to do. For many young people, the conventional teachings on repentance do not sound real. So what are our young people to do when they find themselves living a double life, outside the walls, as it were, and unsure if they know the way back? They look at their parents and perhaps their brothers and sisters and friends and see them looking happy and confident, living in the light, while the poor sinners are miserable, angry, or fearful, living in darkness. The problem is that these double-lived young people think they're outside the gospel when they sinned, beyond the pale, on the other side of the wall. Actually, they are never more in the gospel than in their times of sins. These are the moments when the gospel of Jesus Christ swings into action. It is at its best when people have sinned. That is when atonement and forgiveness really count. Christ came not to heal those who are whole, but those who are sick. The problem then is how to teach the gospel of atonement and forgiveness in a way that young people will recognize that this is the gospel they need when sin troubles their lives. I would wager that nearly all young people need the atonement fairly desperately. If it's not a hidden life of sin, they need it to sustain their strivings. Many young people these days live in a world of high aspiration. They are taught to strive for more skill in music, more victories in sports, greater personal beauty, more popularity, better grades. No matter how hard they try, they fall short, and without meaning to hurt, the people who love them increase the pressure. Striving in itself is not evil, as a people, Latter-day Saints try harder. A friend of my wife's once told her she could not stand Latter-day Saints. They were such overachievers. We build it into our theology and into our songs. We say our goal is godly perfection. Our favorite song for children says, "I am a child of God, and so my needs are great." It is the godly striving within us that gives us a perpetual great need. The more we are told how great we are, the greater our sense of inadequacy. In that world, we'll inevitably feel that we perpetually fall short. We can never achieve all we expect of ourselves or our parents and teachers expect of us. That means we will always feel inadequate, flawed, lacking. That kind of world is only tolerable with something like the atonement available to us. We need the assurance that some power or force outside of ourselves will pick us up and make us whole when we feel imperfect and flawed. We have to realize that the very idea of the atonement implies that sin and shortcomings are built into the structure of the universe. The reason we have an atonement is that God foresaw sin as part of our life. The atonement has no meaning outside of a fallen and imperfect humanity. Our sense of falling short is a sign of our personal failure, is not a sign of our personal failure, but a necessary and inevitable part of life. Once God sets up a standard of glory to which we can aspire, he sets up a metric for failure. We all fall short of the glory of God. The feeling of imperfection, which haunts us as an inevitable byproduct of God's effort to lead us to eternal life and our desire to be like him. We must accept that as a fact of our existence and rely on the Savior whom he has sent to redeem us from our sins. In this Easter season, I pray we all will find comfort and strength for our everyday lives. We can scarcely imagine the powers and peace we could enjoy if we truly embraced the Savior. What if we did everything in his name? What if we remembered him always? Our powers to do good would swell. The good forces in us would be magnified. We would forget ourselves in doing good. We would become sons and daughters of Christ. I pray it will be so. In Christ's name, amen.
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. When through the woods and forest glades I walk, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in.
That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
Taylor, Bailey, and Christian, beautiful. Thank you so very much. You've touched our lives. And Barbara and Brother Bushman, thank you as well for your terrific remarks. We've been blessed by being here tonight. Our keynote speaker this evening, as you all know, is Elder Bruce C. Hafen, an emeritus member of the Quorum of the 70. I think my very favorite part of knowing Elder Hafen is one of his, my favorite parts is his wife, Marie. I'm so grateful for these two, and they've been dear friends of mine for many years, and I'm grateful for their influence in my life. After serving a mission in Germany, Elder Hafen received his undergraduate and law degrees, both from the University of Utah, a forgivable offense, I believe. Brother Bushman. Elder Hafen has played an important part at Brigham Young University for many years. He helped establish the J. Reuben Clark Law School and was a member of its original faculty. He was named Dean of the Law School and also served as the Provost of Brigham Young University for many years. When Elder Hafen was called to be a General Authority 70, he wrote the following. Two subjects have most shaped my attitudes. One subject is family relationships, especially child rearing and marriage. The other is the mission and the atonement of Jesus Christ. Those of us who have listened to Elder Hafen and read his writings are fully aware of how important these subjects are to him and how grateful we are that we have been tutored by him these many years. His faith and his strength and his grace has been such an important part of many of our lives. I feel very blessed to call Elder Hafen a personal friend. His testimony of the Savior, his quick mind and intellect, his genuine love for his family, and his love for people like me. I'm so very grateful for him. I just realized that while I was sitting up here that, you know, a lot of us have books that we're all reading four or five at a time, and I've been listening to more books last few years, and I've just finished a book, Faith is Not Blind, by Elder and Sister Hafen. And I'm on chapter 23 of Rough Stone Rolling. I've read it before, but now I'm listening to the audio version. So, Barbara, your turn. tonight I'm very grateful for each of our speakers, and I'm so grateful to hear from Elder Hafen tonight as he concludes by sharing his testimony of the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. After Elder Hafen finishes, the benediction will be offered by Alice Judd, a junior majoring in psychology from Phoenix, Arizona. Elder Hafen.
Richard and Barbara, thank you for your thoughtful and edifying messages on behalf of everyone here. We have been richly fed. Richard, thanks for coming all the way out here to be with us. Marie and I have a great love for Richard Bushman ever since she was in a class he taught when he was a young faculty member at BYU, and he's blessed us and the church in so many ways ever since. And Dean Dan Judd, he was made the official dean of religious education only a few months ago. He mentioned that I was once the dean on this campus, and I would only say to you, Dan, about your new assignment as you look forward to what's ahead, old deans never die, they just lose their faculties. I hope that helps you. We're in the Joseph Smith Building. There's been a Joseph Smith Building on this campus for a long, long time. All the student wards at BYU met as one ward in the old JSB. The Cougar Eat was in the basement. Those were the good old days. The Joseph Smith Building that was here before this one stood right next to where we are. That's a special place to Marie and to me because we met in a class in the old original JSB next to where we are now. And in fact, we have as a little keepsake a brick from that old building until this building replaced it in 1991. I want to say something about this new building and something that you may not have noticed. I invite you to visualize the large bronze relief sculpture now on the north face of this new Joseph Smith Building. It was beautifully crafted by Franz Johansson of the BYU Art Faculty to depict the building's purpose as the religious teaching center of the campus. At first, Franz did some sketches of Joseph alone, the Joseph Smith Building. It seemed appropriate, but something was missing, the connection between Joseph and the mission of BYU. A prayerful search for that connection led to Joseph's, to the Lord's words spoken to Joseph, now part of the sculpture. I give unto you a commandment, that ye shall teach one another the doctrine of the kingdom. Teach ye diligently, and my grace shall attend you. So the sculpture shows Joseph Smith in the center, standing as if in a keyhole. He does hold the keys of this dispensation. He gestures with scriptures in his right hand as if he were teaching two current BYU students. And he gestures with his left hand toward the children those BYU students hope to teach someday as parents. Behold, look, it's the home-centered, church-supported curriculum that we heard so much about in conference only a few days ago. It's an inspired idea, and it was anticipated and captured right here at BYU in the JSB. And streaming from above are small but bold vertical lines that depict the grace of heaven. We've been talking about that tonight. It's a word that's alive and well among us. These lines intersect with diagonal lines that suggest the interplay between grace and teaching if we teach one another diligently, because that diligence is the condition on which the grace is bestowed. What's diligent? It means careful, serious, determined. It derives from a Latin term that means loving or taking delight in. Looking at the children in that sculpture draws my mind to Nephi's stirring words about talking, rejoicing, and writing about Christ, as Barbara mentioned earlier. So that, as Nephi said, our children may know. Let me put that into Nephi's larger context. Powerful passage. For we labored diligently. There's that strong conditional word again. We labor to persuade our children and also our brethren to believe in Christ. For we know that it is by grace that we are saved after all we can do. He goes on. Yet we also keep the law of Moses and look forward with steadfastness unto Christ until the law of Moses shall be fulfilled. We talk of Christ. We rejoice in Christ. We prophesy of Christ. And we write according to our prophecies that our children may know to what source they may look for a remission of their sins. And we teach them the deadness of the law of Moses, so that our children may look forward to that life which is in Christ. I'm intrigued at how Nephi here introduces the idea that we should persuade our children to believe in Christ. His opening language is among the best known verses in Scripture about the Restoration's unique doctrine of grace. And that doctrine differs significantly from both the Catholic and Protestant traditions. Nephi said, "It is by grace that we are saved after all we can do." When I was a missionary in Germany in the early 1960s, the LDS translation of this verse into German read, "Aus Gnade selig werden, trotz allem, was wir tun können." The word trotz means in spite of or regardless of. In other words, whoever translated that verse from the Book of Mormon into German for the church thought the English phrase meant we are saved by grace regardless of or in spite of whatever we do of our own accord. That doctrine is vintage Martin Luther, the great German reformer, appropriate for a German translation, you say. And it reflects other Luther-like ideas about humankind's natural depravity, our lack of free will, our total incapacity for any righteous action except what the righteousness of Christ enables when he elects to dwell in us. Well, when living in Germany again, 40 years later, I found, sitting in a Sunday school class using the Book of Mormon from my missionary days and comparing it with the one my friend, a church member, was using, I found the saints were using a new Book of Mormon translation, updated by our Church Scriptures Committee. The crucial verse now reads, "Durch Gnade errettet werden nach allem, was wir tun können." Nach is the primary change, and it literally means after. So the phrase now, in the German Book of Mormon, reads exactly as Joseph wrote it. We're saved by grace after, or in addition to, or along with, all we can do. Hooray for the Scriptures Committee, because on the hinge of that one word swings such a huge doctrinal and historical door. I've grown a little concerned that according to some non-Latter-day Saint observers of our church, some recent writing and conversations about grace and Christ's atonement among today's church members are moving the church toward an inaccurate understanding of the relationship between grace and works, drawing on and becoming more consistent with Luther-like doctrines, especially grace-oriented evangelical Protestantism. For example, one evangelical scholar applauds the work of Latter-day Saint writers who he believes, quote, "promote an understanding of the relationship between grace and works that is openly modeled after evangelical teachings." he sees the work of these writers as a move away from Joseph Smith's teachings about the nature of God and man's capacity to become like God, as Joseph expressed in the King Follett Discourse. Why does all this matter? Because the Lord has now restored Christ's original teachings about the fall, human nature, the purpose of the atonement, and the very purpose of life. The doctrines of traditional Christianity were and are misguided about these very basic issues, undermining our initiative, our incentives, and our confidence in our own capacity to learn, to grow, and to become all that our Father sent us here to become. Brothers and sisters, the bitterness we taste in life is not because there's something evil or wrong with us, or with God, or with life. Rather, we taste the bitter that we may learn to prize the good and the sweet. And the atonement of Jesus Christ, the central message of Easter, is not just for the purpose of erasing black marks. It's fundamentally a doctrine of human development that makes our eternal growth both possible and meaningful. I loved how Brother Bushman explained all that. It's part of the plan that we have this experience and need the atonement. And because of the atonement, we can learn from our experience without being condemned by it. At the same time, grace does include certain gifts that are free and unconditional. The universal resurrection, forgiveness for Adam and Eve's original sin, and the very plan of salvation. Because Christ rose from the tomb on that first Easter morning, every one of us will be resurrected. And as Jacob wrote, it is by his grace and his great condescensions unto the children of men that we have power even to come upon the face of the earth, let alone having the opportunity for salvation and eternal life. These universal features of grace are never earned. We never deserve them as if we were entitled to them. If the Lord hadn't freely extended this level of grace to us in the first place, we'd all be totally lost and without hope. But beyond these unconditional dimensions of grace, its other dimensions are conditional. They're still gifts, but they're not free. We qualify for this additional level of grace when we meet certain conditions, not to satisfy some arbitrary standard of works in a mathematical grace works formula, but because of the very nature of human growth. For example, forgiveness is conditioned upon our repentance, which can sometimes make enormous demands of us. Further, the Lord's words on the outside wall of this building say not just to teach, but to teach diligently, and my grace shall attend you. The stories about the Lord delivering the Nephites, the Israelites, or the handcart companies from their bondage and trauma, they show us that the Savior offers us the grace of his strengthening blessings only as we willingly participate in our own deliverance, exerting our strength and faithfulness to the utmost. This voluntary and active participation is absolutely essential to the growth process that results in our spiritual development. As one handcart tragedy survivor put it, we came to know the Lord in our extremities. We don't come to know him in our hammocks, but in our extremities. Even as he extends to us his grace, sometimes the Lord stretches us to the outer edge of our extremities. Can I offer a little illustration? Some of you might know the story of Agnes Caldwell, the 9-year-old who was among the Martin and Willie handcart survivors. Starving and exhausted, little Agnes walked in freezing snow alongside a rescue wagon, hoping for a ride. Finally, the driver asked her, "Sissy, would you like a ride?" He took her outstretched hand. Then he clucked to his horses to speed up, pressing Agnes into a run. She wrote later in her journal, she thought he was the meanest man who ever lived. Then later, when she could stagger no further, he lifted her into the warm comfort of a black blanket in the wagon. Only then, she said, did she realize that if he had let her ride at her first request, she would have frozen to death. The run increased her circulation. The wagon master's severe mercy saved her life. The Lord is our wagon master, but only we, like Agnes, can take certain essential steps. And without our complete engagement, it's not that the Lord's grace won't make us grow, but that it can't. He can't grow for us. Spiritual strength is like a muscle. It will grow only when it's repeatedly stretched, sometimes further, and then further again. Well, with this doctrinal introduction, Nephi urges us to rejoice, write, prophesy, and teach our children to look to Christ as the source of two great blessings. One, the remission of sins, and two, that life which is in Christ. I love that phrase, and I'm glad we can explore it tonight. The Savior is the source of both of these blessings, but not the sole source. Both also require of us all we can do. I think that's why Nephi said that at the beginning. Especially in today's culture of hostility toward religion, we must teach our children to have their own testimonies. They are our most important investigators, as I heard one mission president's wife say. But they can't survive only on borrowed light from their parents or anybody else. The social mainstream is now so polluted that those who want to be believing face the exhausting pushback of always wading upstream against the cultural current. Heber C. Kimball famously prophesied of our day that the Lord's people will face difficulties of such a demanding character that it will be necessary for you, he said, to have a knowledge of the truth of this work for yourself. The time will come when no man or woman will be able to stand on borrowed light. Close quote. The rising generation in Mosiah 26 lived in such a time. Unlike their parents who had heard King Benjamin, many of the young ones couldn't understand the word of God, so they rejected it. Why couldn't they understand? Alma tells us it's because of their unbelief. And that attitude of unbelief can be culturally imposed, just as believing attitudes can be inspired by a culture of belief. We live in an unbelieving culture. Belief precedes understanding. Understanding does not precede belief. So we need to nourish a culture of belief in our homes to help our children understand God's word. Moreover, building Zion means building a multi-generational church on both sides of the veil. Zion isn't completely established in a new location until it becomes a multi-generational church. One of the church's great challenges today, especially internationally, is our need to increase the fraction of members who've been sealed in the temple. Raising families, multi-generational temple-sealed families are the ideal source, although not the only source, for teaching children in a culture of belief. Sometimes, though, we don't foresee the long-term effects of our choices on the next generation. Let me illustrate. A few years ago, I met in the St. George Temple with an 80-year-old man who was there to receive his own endowment. When I learned his name and connected a few dots, I found that he'd been raised in a Latter-day Saint home, and in fact, he was the nephew of a former First Presidency member. He told me a story briefly. After he'd married, he and his wife had several children, then they were divorced, life went on, and finally, at the age of 80, he found his way alone to the temple. I was thrilled for him. Near the end of our visit, he asked me earnestly, "Can I have my children sealed to me now?" His former wife had remarried. Neither she nor his now adult children were active in the church. I saw his tears and my heart hurt for him when I had to explain that child-parent sealings must include two parents, and sealings of adult children must be voluntary. Nobody will be eternally sealed to someone they don't want to be sealed to. Even children born in the covenant will remain eternally sealed to their parents only if they want to be. The good news was that he'd come back. He was worthy to receive the Holy Temple endowment, but it was a bittersweet day for him. Our daughter, Sarah Devigny, once wrote, "I wonder how many people realize that they're tethering their families to the decisions they make as they navigate uncertainty. Some people don't give their own historicity enough thought. Others, like the saints of Nauvoo, invite us to witness their sacrifice and follow their example. They wrote on the Nauvoo temple wall, 'The Lord has beheld our sacrifice. Come after us.'" Sometimes allowing yourself to move forward with even a drop of faith allows you to pass that drop on to your children. if we choose to see ourselves as an isolated figure with isolated choices, we may miss the chance to witness and learn from the sacrifices of those who came before us. And in doing so, we actually blind our own children so they never have the chance to see the sacrifices of our ancestors or to make sacrifices of their own. Our choices take us away, that take us away from the priesthood can take our whole family away from the priesthood. That's the end of Sarah's quote. In addition, teaching our children diligently asks more of us than just taking them to church. I recently became acquainted with a kindly older woman whose father I had known years earlier. Her parents were tirelessly faithful people who served in visible church callings for decades. At one point, I asked her if it had been hard for her to see her father be away from home so much for the church, as good a man as he was. She spoke generously of her love and admiration for him. But as we continued talking, she opened up and expressed a childlike disappointment that she'd never felt she had her own real testimony, her own deep relationship with the Lord. "My parents had such strong faith," she said. "I trusted them completely, and that was enough for me." But now she was wishing she had known more firsthand for herself. She'd supported her own posterity for years in their mission calls and their church activity. But her own lack of spiritual confidence left her feeling a kind of void, limiting her commitment to the temple and to full discipleship. So we talked about DNC section 46, the section on spiritual gifts. One part says, "To some it is given by the Holy Ghost to know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. To others it is given to believe on their words, that they also might have eternal life if they continue faithful." Something about that promise sparked a hopeful look in her eyes. A few days later, I learned from a mutual friend that she was already beginning to fan that spark into her own fire. As we heard only days ago, as mentioned at conference, about the church's new emphasis on a home-centered, church-supported curriculum, President Nelson has asked parents to transform their homes into a sanctuary of faith rather than assuming that church meetings are the primary sources of gospel teachings. The experiences I've mentioned and this prophetic guidance have made me want to understand better what parents can do to teach their children how to develop their own testimonies. Just being church active parents is simply not enough, not today, if it ever was. People value what they discover more than they value what they're told. And children make spiritual discoveries only when their parents teach them diligently, carefully, intentionally, lovingly, and with delight. When I left for my own mission at age 19, in good conscience, I could only say, "I believe the gospel is true." I was kind of stuck on the difference between believing and knowing. But then gradually, through very personal discoveries, I came to know for myself. It is a very personal process. And I wanted to understand how that's working in the lives of other people. As I thought about that sculpture and tonight, I identified a sample of young adults who've developed their own secure spiritual moorings, their own life-giving connection with the Lord. Then I asked them to tell me in writing what their parents had done to help them discover God and the gospel's truth. This is a very dry talk. I'm going to get a drink. Okay. Hitting the bottle renews you, doesn't it? I want to tell you what these kids said because it's delightful. I found that the parents of these wonderful young single adults in my sample, for one thing, they understood and personally modeled the difference between private and public religious behavior. Research for the church has shown that a child's private religious behavior, such as prayer, personal scripture study, and developing a personal relationship with God, is far more likely to lead to adult religious commitments than is public religious behavior alone, such as attending church meetings or church activities, as useful as those things might be. But some parents worry so much about their children becoming inactive that although well-intentioned, they rigidly focus only on public behavior. And their children grow up feeling pressured into church meetings, seminary, missions, even temple marriage, only because they're supposed to participate. I've talked to young people who've told me that's how it was for them. Some of these children don't come to internalize or own these expectations as their own personal, freely chosen discoveries. Then, perhaps on their missions or in their early married years, they may confront hard experiences that jolt their faith. Stunned into a crisis, they may ask for the first time, "Do I really believe this for myself?" Some will look inside their hearts and learn to build their own private, knowing relationship with God. But for others, today, especially when they encounter aggressive anti-church arguments, their faith may wobble and eventually collapse like a shell built around a vacuum. Spiritually sound parents, like those of the sample I found, on the other hand, they know the difference between teaching and preaching, and the children can tell the difference. As one little boy reportedly asked after hearing his grandfather talk in church, "Was that a true story, Grandpa? Or were you just preaching?" They know the difference. And instead of being shocked or making a crisis out of a child's honest questions, these parents calmly use the questions to teach. In one family we know, a 14-year-old boy asked, "Mom, is it okay to not believe in God?" I think she was shocked. But her reply was something like this: "What a wonderful question. That shows you're thinking about very important things. Let's talk more." Now let me quote some comments from our sample of spiritually grounded young adults. First, I was struck by their gratitude for their parents. Here are a few quotations from them. "My parents created an environment of love and of the Spirit in our home. I saw them doing what they asked me to do, praying alone, reading the scriptures, alone and together. I saw them live the gospel when they didn't know I was watching." Another one said, "I watched how my parents treated each other, how they treated each of their kids. And in our family, we talked about the gospel every day as a natural and real part of everyday life." Another one said, "What my parents put first in their lives showed me what's most important in life." And another one, "I've watched them go through the repentance process. That helped me see how the gospel changes lives." And one more, "My parents have gotten through tough times because of their faith, and that has shown us kids that it's real." Well, I also asked, what had these parents done specifically to help their children develop their own testimonies, those personal, private discoveries? Here are some things they said. "They turned me to the Lord to find my own answers and encouraged me to live the answers I found. They helped me get to places where I could figure out things on my own, like EFY, girls' camp, temple baptisms, and church history sites." Another one said, "A testimony has to be gained independently. My parents have done their best to make sure their kids gain independence with everything, especially the gospel. I've grown more by studying on my own than by having someone else do the studying for me." Another one put it this way, "Because of their example, they've helped me want to gain my testimony. Not just that I need or should gain a testimony, they taught me the what, who, and how of the gospel. This laid the foundation for what was mine to discover the why I need the gospel in my life." And one more, "My parents understood that most kids at some point naturally realize they need to know for themselves. So they let me piggyback on their testimony until I was strong enough to gain my own. They first showed me the motions. Now I'm able to stand on my own 2 feet and teach my own children." She's saying this before she has children, but notice her natural multi-generational instinct. Nephi said they taught their children to have their own faith in Christ. First, so they know to what source they should look for a remission of their sins. And second, Nephi wanted his children to know the deadness of a Law of Moses approach to the gospel, so his children could comprehend the life which is in Christ. What is the life which is in Christ? Part of it is that he is the ultimate source of charity as well as forgiveness, the final source of strength and perfection as well as redemption. I have a friend whose son was married in the temple, and he and his wife had several children. They were all active in the church, but after the children were grown, a pattern of tension and criticism began growing between the parents. I'll skip the details, but within a few years, that tension had grown into mutual mistrust and sometimes hostility between husband and wife. Neither had violated temple covenants. They said they didn't want a divorce, but marriage counseling hadn't helped, and they were continually arguing about personal issues that filled their lives with miserable contention, and it was getting worse. When my friend recently asked for advice on how to help his son and his wife, I felt his love and empathy for both of them. And I told him honestly, I didn't know anything he didn't know about such difficulties. But then I remembered an experience I'd had, and I shared it with him. It hadn't struck me as a story about marriage until that visit with my friend. Let me tell you the story. During my church service, I was assigned to review a church member's appeal of a stake disciplinary council decision to excommunicate him from the church. He had appealed that decision to the church. As I reviewed the disciplinary council's minutes, I had difficulty understanding why the council had decided on excommunication. Seeking clarification, I called the stake president, a gentle, quiet man who was new in his calling. He said the case involved two capable men in his stake who had once been good friends. Then they had a misunderstanding that gradually escalated into a long and angry quarrel that affected both families, fueled by mutual claims of gossip and harsh criticism. One of the men, who'd for years been a forceful leader in their stake, the stake president told me, he felt so much righteous indignation about this conflict that he essentially demanded the other man's excommunication, and somehow he persuaded the disciplinary council to agree with him. The man was excommunicated, and then he appealed the council's decision. Rather than upholding or denying the appeal, the authorized church leaders then asked that stake president to hold a new disciplinary council. So these two men and their supporting witnesses attended again. They presented basically and emotionally what they had done before. After the witnesses were excused and the council began its private deliberations, these two men sat silently smoldering outside the high council room, awaiting the decision. After a time of silent waiting, one of these men suddenly stood up, walked over to the other man, and knelt down in front of him and began to cry. And he said, "What on earth are we doing to each other? Can you possibly forgive me?" The other man was stunned, but his heart melted. Within a few minutes, these two men had embraced and wept and repeatedly apologized to each other. They knocked on the high council room door. The council members who were in deliberating were astonished to see these two former adversaries standing there crying in the doorway, their arms around each other. After the two gave a brief explanation, the room erupted in tears of joy and relief and gratitude and embracing. The next day, the stake president called to tell me what had happened. As I choked back my own tears, I asked if he knew what had prompted the one man to approach the other. He knew only that the Spirit of the Lord had somehow touched their hearts. That was that. No more disciplinary counsel, no more contention. This experience reminds me of those peaceful years after Christ's visit to the Nephites. We read in the Book of Mormon, there was no more contention in the land because of the love of God, which did dwell in the hearts of the people. It was Christ himself, personally, who had touched and taught those people and their children so profoundly. In Nephi's words, they knew firsthand to what source they should look, not only for a remission of their sins, but to find that life which is in Christ, as opposed to the deadness of the law of Moses with its emphasis on an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Brothers and sisters, can you imagine how many marriages, how many families, how many personal relationships could and can be healed by finding this form of life? The Savior said, I am the resurrection and the life. Tonight, this Easter, I bow in gratitude not only for the physical resurrection, but also for the new life of charity and peace that can be found through Christ Jesus. How do we access such a sacred power? I don't want to minimize the complexities and entanglements that confound the personal relationships all around us, including sometimes our own. I'm not talking about just shouting a cliche or waving a magic wand. Our personal entanglements usually don't happen all at once, and usually we can disentangle them only one knot and one loop at a time, like tangled fishing lines, prayerfully and patiently calling on all the forbearance and self-discipline and love that we can muster. But there is also a deeper resource known and available to the saints of the Most High and to their children if they have been diligently taught to know Christ. I believe it was the spiritual gift of charity that descended upon that first man in that story. That resource, that grace, is not some autonomous wellspring in the sky. It is rather the spiritual power that flows from our atonement-based relationship with the Savior, much of it coming through the instrumentality of the Holy Ghost. And on what condition? Moroni said, God bestows charity upon all who are true followers of his Son. Well, how did charity break through the barriers between these two men with all that contention, healing their hearts to change them so completely? I don't know firsthand what happened, but I believe this. First, the Lord did not simply zap them against their will or as if they had no will. That might be Luther's interpretation. But no, through the promptings of the Holy Ghost, the Lord offered his hand and his charity. The first man recognized it and took it. The second man responded in kind. They both yielded to the enticings of the Holy Spirit and put off the natural man, as King Benjamin put it. Second, I believe these men were both able to respond as they did because they'd previously been taught diligently to what source they should look, to forgive, to be forgiven, and to grasp the life which is in Christ. Like Enos in the forest or young Alma on the earth, in the pivotal moment when these two men had spent their fury, they remembered what their parents or their missionaries had taught them about the teachings of Jesus. Third, even true followers of Christ are imperfect, as these men were. But we can satisfy the conditions of grace in the midst of our weaknesses, sometimes even because of a weakness, when we choose to give it up with his help and turn to him. The Lord graciously bestows the gifts of his Spirit for the benefit of those who love me and keep all my commandments, and him that seeketh so to do. On a recent family handcart trek visit to Wyoming, with all of our little grandkids and their parents gathered around, we're talking about the Martin and Willie experience. And we noted that most historians believe the decision of the Martin and Willie companies to begin their handcart journey so late in the year was an ill-advised mistake. But after a group vote, that was their choice to go. So I asked our family members, did we come to Martin's Cove to celebrate a mistake? There was a pause. Then one of our grandchildren raised a hand and said, we all make mistakes. Sometimes really dumb ones. We're here to honor and learn from these people and those who rescue them because of their faith and sacrifice to overcome the effects of their mistakes. Knowing that the Lord helps us do that means more to me than if he only helps us when we're perfect, saved by grace, after enduring all we can do. Let's look again now at the relief sculpture on this building and its message about the grace that's bestowed on us when we teach diligently, whether as students or parents. Once, quite a few years ago, our granddaughter, Sarah Ann, then about 4 years old, was walking across a crowded BYU campus with her aunt, also named Sarah, who was then a BYU student. Notice the streams of light on the BYU students in this precious image, streaming symbols of grace. when the Carillon bell tower chimed the top of the hour, most of the students on the quad scurried quickly to their next class, leaving the two Sarahs to walk almost alone. As little Sarah saw all those students scattering into the surrounding buildings, she looked up and asked her aunt in childlike wonder, "Are the BYU students going into those buildings so they can learn about the temple?" That was a young child's instinct about the core purpose of BYU. It was probably her take on whatever her parents, both BYU graduates, had been teaching her, and she was pretty close. Both for now and as future parents, may we teach ye diligently, and my grace shall attend you, bringing love and delight into our lives and the lives of our posterity. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ lives. It's Easter. He is risen. The gospel is true. He loves each one of us. In all our weaknesses, in all our efforts, teach diligently, live diligently. His grace will attend us. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Our Father in heaven, we thank thee for a wonderful evening that we got to spend together. We thank thee for our speakers and our friends for coming together and instructing us and giving us a chance to be instructed by thee. We thank thee dearly for the space to ponder and converse and ponder more on thy love and this opportunity of life that we've been given. We pray for patience in learning and patience in growing, and most especially for thy assistance in doing both. We thank thee for our families and those who love us, and we thank thee for our Savior. We pray for a safe drive home, and that we may be directed to those who need us the way that we need thee. And we love thee, and we say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.